There have been 4 or 5 topics I've been meaning to write about for a new video, but a certain game has stolen all my attention and inspiration in a good way. That game is The Longing by Studio Seufz. It's an adventure idle game, but it's like nothing I've ever seen before. We might all be familiar with an idle game or two and have an idea of what the genre looks like. I've played a few and found them sweet and relaxing sometimes. They're games you can leave alone for long periods of time, and they play themselves. They're usually characterized by super dense feedback, time-based resource management, investment gameplay, and attractive but costly upgrades. And at the center of many of these idle games is a provoked kind of jittery impatience to level up now, instead of waiting 6 hours to research an upgrade or for money to save up. But The Longing flips all this on its head. The Longing is an idle game stripped of all of the gimmicks, and it's much more like an adventure game with its fantastical narrative. In it, you control a little creature called a shade and help them pass the time as they wait 400 days before they can wake up their king, who is slumbering at the bottom of an immense cave system. That's 400 real days. The clock starts as soon as you load up the game and start walking around. And walking is much of the gameplay. You can control where the shade walks, what they interact with, and how they pass the 400 days. Instead of incessant clicking or intense resource allocation, the main mechanic, resource, and obstacle of this game is time. Not only the passage of time, but how to spend it. And although there are ways to help time move faster, they all make sense for the game, and you can't purchase upgrades or watch ads to get them. Instead, you have to commit to the game's quiet, slow, and contemplative pace. It sounds like a weird game to be so excited about, but I've always adored games that bend genres or make us reconsider what a game even is. I love how playing this game makes me think and feel. It's somber and a little sad, but there's so much potential for empathy, relaxation, mindfulness, and joy tucked away in the recesses of our Shade's Earth Palace. But I'm getting ahead of myself. This is a screen therapy review, so I'm not just going to be telling you about the gameplay and my thoughts on it. I'll be bringing in some media psychology research to help explain why some of us can love a game meant to be excruciatingly slow and lonely, and ways that it might even boost our emotional well-being. The Longing doesn't have very complex mechanics. You walk around, pick stuff up, and sometimes you talk to yourself or make a choice. True of many of my favorite independent games, the mechanics aren't where the gameplay is. The Longing isn't about the agility in which you can walk or pick things up. Its true challenges take place in our minds and test a very different but infinitely useful set of skills. In this video, I want to talk about the 2 levels of gameplay we can find in The Longing, both of which I love because they're very difficult, both in-game and in real life. These 2 levels of play are the challenges of time and the challenges of self. First, let's address the obvious mechanic and theme of the game. In our minute counting, sometimes second counting societies, the fact that this game demands to be taken slowly and methodically rebels against everything we know about modern pop games, and for me, life in general. The gameplay forces you to slow down with it, to practice patience. Of course, you could just visit your shade for 2 minutes a day, or once a week, or once a year, and still win the game. But if you're curious and patient and actually play, you can discover what it feels like to be challenged by time. To be told, no, you can't have that right now, even if you would pay me for it. I'm sorry, but you're just going to have to wait. That's not something we're usually told in games, but when you play The Longing, suddenly you're in a headspace developers are traditionally terrified of putting gamers in. In fact, they often jam-pack games with as many flashing lights and pinging sounds as possible to keep us from these shunned thoughts. That's the, oh my god, this is taking forever, everything is so slow headspace. The Longing instead went out of its way to put us there. Your shade isn't in a hurry to do anything. In fact, they walk very slowly because they're much more willing to let time tick by between steps than be in a rush. There's no hold shift to run and no walk faster upgrades, and even doing simple tasks can take a long, long time. And this has scared a lot of players away from the game. It's also aggravated players from playing more than 5 minutes of it. But for me, and a growing number of players, this has actually been very relaxing. I think a game like The Longing is very useful for its meditative qualities. It can be used as a tool to help us remember how to slow down and think for a little bit. Studies show that games, depending on their design and players' openness, can be used to deepen our mindfulness. And practicing mindfulness can, by extension, increase our emotional well-being. And that's what I've been gaining from how slow this game is. Somewhere between getting my shade from point A to point B, watching them walk, listening to their little footsteps, kind of lost in the trance-like music, I discovered something about myself I didn't know before. I would really like some quiet in my life. I don't mean less noise, but time dedicated to nothing in particular. Time spent walking, thinking, staring out windows. I'm always moving a mile a minute in real life, or at least my mind is. If I'm not working, I'm creating. If I'm not creating, I'm planning when to create. Doing chores, minding responsibilities, tending to relationships, or multitasking hobbies. I'm a chronic, undersleeping, overachieving perfectionist. But when I loaded up the game for the first time and was met with the first moment of quiet stillness after the cutscene, I was struck by how much I liked it. I had thought I would need time to get used to the tone of the game, to muscle past the "this is taking forever" feeling, but instead it felt immediately soothing. I hadn't realized I had forgotten what it was like to just be still. And it's actually gotten a little worse with quarantine now that the different sections of my life have lost their partitions and everything's blending together at all hours of the day. I was surprised to realize that, like many players out there, I was actually a little jealous of my shade. Because somehow, it's an option for my shade to sit and stare happily into space from a comfy armchair, but not for me. Using the game as a tool for mindful reflection, I thought on this during the meditative gameplay, and I've discovered a few reasons for my non-stop nature. One is that I don't give myself permission to enjoy the quiet. Although I rationally know productivity culture can be harmful for our well-being, my knee-jerk reaction to every quiet moment in my life is, "What else should I be doing right now?" Another reason quiet moments aren't a thing for me is because, as most people with a history of anxiety can attest, I can sometimes get a little scared of my own thoughts. Even so, I always find meditation and journaling to boost my mental health and mood, but I still don't find enough time to do those things for myself, prioritizing everything else first. So when the shade says that he needs some time to sit and think, I feel that, I really do. And what I really enjoy is that in the shade's world, the only priority is to take care of their mind and focus on how to enrich their time with themselves. Our little shade doesn't have to worry about any other responsibilities or conflicting obligations beyond waiting to wake the king. Most of us weren't taught how to create a space for self-reflection or how to ask for one from our loved ones, or worst of all, we bought it when we were told that self-care and self-enrichment could wait till after all your other work was done, if it was ever done. But when time is all you have, when it's both the only obstacle and the only resource, you get practice appreciating the present moment. You can get to a very zen headspace. In this way, the longing and games like it can help us practice some elements of mindfulness. Guiding my shade, I'm able to practice a perspective I haven't tried in a long time. I was able to forget about the future. Usually I live in the future. It's a bad habit of mine, always planning, never really alive to the present moment. But with 400 days ahead of me in the game, and only a few things to do at a time, and only very slowly, I found myself forgetting about the end of the game, forgetting any impatience. I just focused on the next few minutes, just getting to the next door, or getting to the next lump of coal. I thought I would fixate on the mysterious ending of the game, wishing it to happen sooner. But actually, I ended up just wanting to make the next few hours okay, or maybe even comfortable for my shade. In this way, I stumbled into practicing mindfulness, which this game accomplishes for us in a very clever way. It lured me into its crawling pace by making me feel bad for my shade. And that's pretty remarkable for a game, to have you care more about a character than winning the game. Immediately after starting the game, I kind of adopted my shade as a Tamagotchi I really wanted to take care of. And sometimes I even kind of find myself relating to him a little. Which brings me to the deeper and more difficult level of gameplay, self. When I say the self is a level of gameplay, what I mean by this is that although we don't have to experience the isolation directly since this is an idle game, our little shade's true challenge is how to live alone with himself. Right now, many of us might be feeling isolated and longing to explore the world, and so we can empathize with our shade. We might even have similar thoughts and feelings of loneliness. What the shade is truly struggling with isn't how to get from day to day. Instead, it's how to fill that time in a way that's meaningful for them. This game is about helping the Shade enjoy his time in his own company by exploring new hobbies and beautifying his home in a self-expressive way. So surprisingly, one of the main challenges of this game is to engage in self-care. We spend hours on hours doing completely optional tasks just to provide our little Shade with enrichment opportunities. My empathy for my Shade is immense. I love looking after him, and I've come to understand it's because by taking care of him, I'm kind of reminding myself to take care of me. Studies have shown that we develop feelings of connection to in-game avatars and playable characters. We begin to relate to them emotionally, seeing our similarities, and will even subconsciously begin treating ourselves in similar ways that we take care of our avatars or characters. When I spend hours minding the game as it idles in the background just so I can get a pretty crystal for my Shade to make his home a little cozier, I'm actually expressing a certain desire to take care of myself in a similar way during my own quarantine. To invest in my own comfort and self-compassion as an intrinsically worthwhile mission that doesn't need justification or apology. By setting him up to read by the fireplace, it speeds up time, sure, but I also just love seeing him happy. I'm reminded that not everything I do in life needs a finished product, but can be nice to do in itself. In this way, the longing has that great combination of identification and social cognitive theory benefits. We identify with our Shade, seeing ourselves in them thanks to realistic monologues and relatable wishes. And by acting out the game's self-care objectives, we're both learning and showing ourselves how important and worthwhile it is to invest in self-care. After all, if we're able to set aside hours to take care of our little guy, then we should be able to do the same for ourselves once in a while too. It seems silly to gain so much perspective from an idle game, but this is what media is for. To provide us opportunities to replenish psychological resources, to give us a space to relax or challenge our understandings of the world or ourselves. And the longing has been providing me with the comforting reminder that leading a fulfilled life day to day is a feat in and of itself that requires my time, attention, and self-compassion. I was reminded to engage in self-care and take some quiet time just to think and feel without needing an excuse. Looking back on my recent actions, I have been collecting more real-life resources, ordering things from Amazon, brainstorming new creative hobbies, decorating, and subsequently finding a new sense of peace with my surroundings. And I don't think it's drastic to say that this game might have inspired some of that. Conclusion. I highly recommend this game. It takes a certain type of gamer to enjoy it, and everyone will have their own unique experience. But if you've liked the sound of it so far, please don't hesitate to try it out and see what benefits you gain from it. In the end, the real gameplay of The Longing is the journey to cope with one of the greatest challenges we all face in our day-to-day lives, especially right now, how to be alone with ourselves. We often do everything we can to avoid time alone, and this is at the center of my interest in media psychology. Sometimes we use games and movies to get away from dealing with ourselves, our fears and anxieties a little too much. I'm guilty of this sometimes. And that's why I've been loving The Longing so much, because it's challenged me to recognize how I've been spending my time and the state of my relationship with myself and the hours I spend too busy to sit quietly and enjoy getting to know myself. Our compassion for our Shade and his loneliness can turn into real compassion for ourselves, just as our investment in making a better day-to-day life for him can make its way into our real lives too. And as you may have noticed, I didn't talk about the ending of the game. I'm still not sure what's going to happen when I get my little guy to the end. I actually don't even care too much, and that's the point. Some people might say you win a waiting game by being patient or staying focused on the end goal. But what The Longing has taught me, the only way to truly win a waiting game is to stop waiting and to truly treasure the time ticking by and make the most of every moment. I'm caught in a waiting game in real life right now, stuck at home and away from friends, but I don't have a countdown clock over my head. Who knows when the waiting's gonna stop? But the best thing we can do is remember that the time ticking by right now is valuable too. If we're mindful, curious, creative, and compassionate, we can learn to treat ourselves with the same gentleness we treat our little Shade by making our own little safe spaces to rest, bide the time, understand ourselves better, enrich our hearts and minds, and maybe even appreciate the odd quiet moment sometimes. Thank you for watching. If you'd like to see more videos about video games, movies, and mental health, and the intersection of media psychology and well-being, please go ahead and subscribe. Thank you. And as always, happy playing.